But this week, I have a real funny sermon title. It seems strange. It seems odd. Those who have already heard it are saying, what's this all about? I'm calling it the dangers of giving. The dangers of giving. You say, and some of you might say, well, that's, you know, that's not a good sermon to preach when the church needs money. You don't preach on the dangers of giving. I mean, we want people to be encouraged to give more, not to be discouraged. But there's a reason why I'm preaching this message first, before I talk about the blessings. Because according to Jesus, giving, even giving to a good cause, is not the bottom line. Giving is not the bottom line. Jesus is far more concerned as to why we are giving than that we are giving. At least that's what I read in the scriptures, and that's what we're going to look at today. The most important thing to God, it seems to me as I look at the scriptures, is not accomplishing outward goals. In the world and in our by nature, I think that's kind of where we lean to. Like, okay, here's a goal, here's where we got to go, and boom, as long as we accomplish that goal, that's the main thing. But God is much more concerned, it's not as wrong with goals, of course he wants us to accomplish things, but God is much more concerned as to what's going on in our hearts on the way to accomplishing that goal. Why are we doing what we're doing? Heart stuff, motive, attitude, that's what God's most concerned about, not just results. Because you can get results, but you can get them with the wrong attitude and the wrong motives. Would you agree with that? And God's most concerned about what's going on inside of our hearts. Now, I'm going to look at, I've got four things on the outline here. I doubt we'll probably get to number four, and that's okay. I want to discuss the first three anyhow. Different dangers that there are in giving money to God, to the Lord's work, and giving money to the church. You say, can there possibly be any dangers in giving money to the church? As I read the scriptures, I think the answer is yes. It depends why we are doing it. And you might say, well, why are you bringing this subject up this way? The reason I am is because as I started looking in the Bible, you know, we're talking about a sermon on giving. As I started looking in the Bible and what Jesus was saying about giving, that's the first theme that came up. That's the most predominant theme that came up. It's almost like Jesus assumes that we'll give, but his main concern is be careful. Be careful how you give and why you're giving. Be careful about what's going on in your heart. And so, if that's what Jesus said is the, you know, like the most important thing as far as he's concerned when he starts talking about this subject, if he says it is, I think it's good that we talk about it. Don't you agree? Am I on the right spot here? I mean, I think it's, if it's important to Jesus, it should be important to us. So that's why I chose to first address that aspect, because Jesus first addressed it that way. Okay, three. Let's go here. What are three dangers in giving to the Lord's work? Number one, trying to impress God. Luke 18, 9 and 11 to 12. We'll just read that and I'll get into what's going on here. To some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everybody else, and Jesus told this parable, the Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself, God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I get. I make sure the first 10% goes to you. Aren't I wonderful, God? Not like these people. Do you think Jesus is impressed with an attitude like that? But he was giving consistently, sacrificially. Why aren't we applauding? Jesus wasn't. Does this make sense? It is possible to give in such a way as to try to impress God in order to earn his favor. Is that the way we earn God's favor? Look at, as we go on to the next section here, he goes on to say in verses 13 to 14, Jesus says, but the tax collector, they were despised people. They were kind of rip-off artists and stuff like that. They used to siphon off money for themselves, really despised in that culture. But the tax collector, we still don't like tax collectors, do we? Let's face it. Let's be honest. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but beat his breast and said, God have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you, this man, the tax collector, rather than the other man, the Pharisee who thought he was doing so many wonderful things for God, the tax collector, not the Pharisee, went home justified before God. What's that mean, justified? It means to be declared just. It's like a legal term in court. You're not guilty. Boom, you're justified. It means you're justified before God. As far as God's concerned, there's nothing wrong with you. You are totally guiltless. I totally approve of you. Don't you want to be that way before God? So how do I get that way before God? By doing wonderful sacrifices. Hey, God, aren't you impressed with me? Is that the way I get justified before God according to this verse? According to this verse, the way I get justified before God is to realize, you know, Lord, there's really nothing I can really do to impress you as far as in and of myself. You're just so gracious to me. I don't deserve anything. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And God says, I love that. In my sight, you are totally clean and accepted. Justified. Isn't that funny? It's the exact opposite of what you'd think, isn't it? Christianity is radical. It really is. It's based on grace. On the grace of God towards humble people who aren't trying to impress God or impress others. And that grace of, oh God, I just don't deserve it. That grace of receiving that wonderful forgiveness, that's what transforms us from the inside out. It's the grace of God that ultimately transforms us from the inside out. Not our wonderful efforts. And how wonderful am I? Would you agree with this? This is a gospel message, isn't it? This is something that we're going to be doing communion here. You say, how can God do that? How can He just declare totally righteous people who are, humbly admit that there's shortcomings? How can He do that? Because they still have shortcomings. It's because Jesus Christ came and died on the cross, and all our failures, all our sins were placed on Him. And if we just humble ourselves before God, God says, that's okay, I can totally forgive you. You are 100% righteous in my sight because Jesus Christ died on the cross in your place and paid the price. It's called grace. Forgiveness. It transforms us. When we get a hold of it, it transforms us. Jesus said, for everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but he who humbled himself will be exalted. Well, this is radical, as I say. And all we can do is kind of humble ourselves before God. And that's living in the grace of God, living in the love of God. That's the gospel. That's what transforms us. And so Jesus is saying, be careful when you give that you're not trying to impress me. And so, okay, now you'll accept me, God, because, I'm doing this wonderful sacrificial giving. Be careful, God says. Don't enter this pride thing. And Jesus gives an indication here as to how do you know when you're starting to enter into this. Because, let's be honest, we're human beings. We all can enter into these traps. I know I can. I still do.